Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh and we are going to start with our NCRT. So today you have the history class. So we are going to start with 11th standard history. All right. And you can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures, as these lectures are basically, you know, based on the history books or based on the NCRT books. Okay. So you can supplement your preparation. These lectures are basically very useful for those students which are preparing for the civil services examination, right? And as well as other government competitive examination, because you require to answer the few questions related to the current affairs also. So current affairs as well as your basic knowledge, that is called static knowledge based on the history also. Okay. So that is something you must understand. Okay. So let's begin with the lecture, that is 8th standard NCRT book. Okay. Okay. So first is, the first chapter is says that when and where. Okay. So that is basically gives you the information related to the historical underpinning of your of our history. So let's start with from 1817. Okay. So in the 1817, the James Mill, who was nothing but the Scottish economist and the philosopher also. Okay. So which has basically published, you know, a 3-volume of the work. Okay. So that is the history of the British India, that was basically related to his work. Okay. So, you know, he divided basically the Indian history basically, you know, into the 3 periods. All right. So that is based on, you know, the related to basically your religious or religious perspective. Okay. So that is based on the Hindu, that means the ancient India, the basically ruled basically by the Hindu rulers. In the medieval India, the rulers basically belongs to the Muslim. Okay. And the modern time basically ruled by the British. Okay. So these were the 3 periods that were ruled by the Hindu, Muslim and the British. Okay. This period came to be widely accepted, or this periodization came to be widely accepted, because obviously the main purpose of the British colonial rulers is to divide the country based on the communal lines. Okay. So that was the mentality on that time, to divide and rule the country. Okay. Then we can try to divide our history into the different periods to capture the characteristic of the time and some of the most salient features as they appear to us. Okay. So you can publish, or you can say that the period, we can say the ancient part was basically ruled by the Hindu, the medieval was basically ruled by the Muslims, and the modern was basically ruled by the British. Okay. Now, if you could move away from the Scottish, you know, the economist, that is James Mill's classification, you can say the ancient historian or the historians basically divided the Indian history into 3 parts or 3 subparts, that is called ancient history, medieval history and modern history, as you already know. Okay. Now you can say that the one more important source of Indian history obviously the official records of the British administration, because previously during ancient time or during medieval time, there was no such, you know, exhaustive way by which you can record, you know, some sort of administrative features. Obviously there was some aspect which were written down. For example, Ashoka has, you know, basically the, you know, habit of, you know, making of writing of basically on, you know, rock, you know, architecture. So something like that, he has built the elaborate stupas in which he has sent the messages. Okay. But from the British onward, the official record making process was basically started. Okay. That was basically, you know, the Britishers believe that if you write, you know, some of the important historical aspect, that will be beneficial for the governing of this country also. Okay, so the instruction, so every such instruction, plan, policy, decision, agreement, investigation has to be clearly written up. Okay, that is also based on the belief of the British that it would have everything on the written form that would be beneficial for administering this country also. Okay, now by the end of or by the middle of 19th century, okay, the printing, as you know, that the printing, making the copies of the records, right, related to, you know, the judicial proceedings and all sort of things started, goes up. Okay, that is basically at the departmental level. Now the practice of surveying, right, as a department was also, you know, become very common during the colonial administration, because they want to gather as many as information or as much as information they can get, okay, from the various sources. So they started making, or they started doing the survey also, okay, which is based on the surveying criteria. Now these records tell us, right, what the official thought, okay, what they are interested in and what they wished for, basically for, you know, for the development of the our country. So obviously they were mainly focusing on the draining of the wealth from our country. They were only focusing on, or they were only interested in, like, more and more exploitation through all such record work. Okay, so these records were basically help them to, you know, to exploit more and more, because that was the way the Britishers basically used to do. Okay, now these records also help us to understand the other people in the country, what they felt, right, how they left behind, what were the reasons behind all such actions. So many such information also provided by such, you know, records. Okay, now as you know that the printing or modern printing newspapers were basically started with the advent of the British. Okay, now with the printing of the newspapers, right, the pamphlets, the public debate was started. Okay, the important issues basically comes between the public. They started debating on the various issues. Okay, and that is something to be understood. Now, as you know that there were various leaders which were basically, you know, spread their ideas. Okay, so these ideas were basically, you know, related to, you know, the freedom struggle, related to the noble ideas, right, which express their feelings. And these newspapers were to be written, right, and were to be read, right, among the people. Okay, now the history is about to change that occur over the time. So what is history? History is basically the time underpinning over which the certain records have been recorded, or certain, you know, the incidents which have been happened. Okay, it's about finding out how the things were in the past, okay, and how these things basically changed in the present. So we will have certain timeline based on which we will have the historical, the underpinning of the events. Okay, so these were basically related to the historical studies. So in the history, what we do, we can compare the past with the present. Okay, we can talk about some time that there was this time that was the historical, or that was the administration. Okay, we can talk, right, before and after. So we will have certain time period, okay, within which we basically study, okay, all such aspect related to the history. Okay, if someone asks you, right, when the people started drinking the tea or coffee, obviously it will be difficult to answer such question, because it is not that in a single day the people started using this tea and coffee. Okay, so obviously this taste would have developed over the period of the time. Okay, now it's not something that in a particular day, that was a day that was dedicated to starting of the tea and something like that. So there was some span of the time, okay, some time period. Okay, approximately you can say that this time may would have, or this time would have been, you know, the time for the starting of certain changes. So changes were visible after that one. So that is basically something to be noted in the historical studies. Okay. Now, obviously, we would associate the study of the history with some dates. So we will say that at that in this date, something happens. Okay. So historical account will be taken, right? For example, the battles, wars, events, the changes in the regime, changes in the administration, right? The taken over, possession, looting, all such incidents were basically noted down. Okay. specifically in the string of days. Okay, then we also noted down the rulers, their policies, right? For example, you have the Mughal rulers, then you have the British rulers. We were basically noting down of those policies related to their rule. Okay, you know, the historians also interested in when the king was basically crowned, right? The date of marriage, the year of marriage of the crown or the king, okay? When he fought the particular battle, who won that battle, okay? What was the dates? All such things are basically to be studied in, you know, in the historical books. So the historians basically study all such events. Okay. Next, you know, why, you know, the particular set of date is important, okay? Then how do you determine that particular date is very important? So that is something you have to study. Okay. So the date is important because, you know, you have to compare our story with the past. Okay. That is something, you know, something very important for the historical work. Okay. So you must understand, to understand your history, you have to understand, you know, the dates within which certain incident happened. Okay. So they become very, very important because we focus on the particular set of events. Okay. That particular set of events basically are enumerated in the historical books that you have studied also. Okay. And these historians are basically, some of the historians basically are Indian origin. Some of them basically are Britishers. So the British historians basically written down the books based on the British perspective. Okay. So for understanding that British perspective, the rule of each governor general was important because obviously the historians also have certain alignment with the rulers also. Okay. Now these histories written down or written form of the histories basically begin from the first governor general, that was Warren Hastings. Okay. And that was lasted with the last viceroy, that was Lord Mountbatten, because at that point of the time, you know, the British rule was ended in 1947. Okay. So the historical underpinning related to the British administration is basically, you know, respect to those study of the Governor General, right, from the first to the last, as well as, you know, the history which was written by the British historian is also most important to understand, right? The histories related to the British India or modern India. Okay. As you know that James Mill, who was Scottish economist and political philosopher, who have written down, you know, elaborate work or three volumes of the book, that is the history of the British India. Okay. And he has basically divided the country into the three periods, right? That is basically, you know, the Hindu, Muslim and the British. That means during ancient period of the time, right, the Hindu basically ruled. Okay, and during medieval period, the Muslim rulers were there. Okay, and during British period or during the modern period, it was basically, you know, the Britishers basically ruled. Okay, that is something to be divided by James Mill. Okay, now we can divide our history into different periods, obviously, based on the ancient India, based on medieval India, based on the modern India. Okay, all such things basically also, you know, appear to us. So it depends on the historians who basically work under, you know, different parameters. Okay, now, so we prioritize the demarcate the difference between the periods, which was very important. Okay, so these periods are basically, you know, to study some of the historical underpinnings under the study of history. Okay. So Mill was in the opinion that all Asian societies were of lower level of civilization than the Europe. So obviously, you know, white man's supremacy, that was, you know, the idea the Britishers basically, propagated. Okay. So that was basically the idea that was propagated. So the Britishers basically considered that all Asian societies, basically are inferior to the civilizations that is there in the Europe. Okay, so that is something to be important because the British considered, right, considered to be superior than your Asiatic societies. So in his story, according to his study, so according to his telling of the story, before the British came to India, the Hindu and Muslims were despotic ruled the country. Okay, so according to him, the despotic rulers are those rulers which basically, you know, rule the country, right, based on, you know, his whims and the fancies, right? There was no rational criteria, right? So there was no rational criteria to basically, you know, to rule the country. So that was basically, you know, the important aspect as per the J.S. Mill. Okay. There was religious intolerance, caste taboos, okay, which dominated the social life, right? The British rule, as the Mill thought, could civilize the India. That was the white man's burden. Okay. So that was the time when the Mill or the all the Britishers thought that the British rule would be beneficial for India, that would civilize the India, right? Because there was a lot of intolerance, lot of caste taboos, okay? There were a lot of, you know, the caste-related conflicts, the religious-related conflicts were there, okay? Now, obviously, the Britishers basically prejudiced, right, in understanding or in classifying the Indian history, okay? So that was basically the British classification cannot be justified, because you must understand there were a lot of faults that were basically existed, right, along with the Hindu and Muslims during that period of the time also. Okay. So historians also divided the country, also divided this history based on the three, you know, basically, you know, different, you know, the time, that is ancient history, medieval history, and the modern history. Okay. Now, this division itself has a problem, because what we have borrowed this division of the history based on the Western concept, okay? When the modern period is associated with the growth of all modern forces. That was because modern period is basically associated with the growth of science, the growth of reasoning, the growth of democratic states, okay? So all such factors also associate us with the Western concept of the divideation. Okay. When you say the medieval period of the society, basically are those societies where this modern form of, you know, the changes do not exist. So that was, you know, you don't have basically, you know, all such the scientific inventions, the scientific, the reasoning, the democratic functioning of the state, that was not there. Okay. That was not there. And that was not there. Okay. That was the most point of the time. Okay. But the features of the modern period was not visible in India during the British rule. Okay. Because the Britishers basically, are more interested towards the exploitation rather than the development of our country. Obviously, the modern part that were associated with the British rule, that were not really based on the science, based on the reasons, based on the democracy. Okay, all such things basically also impacted. All right, so that were also associated, right? So all such the modern period, all such important aspect related to modern period was also not visible at that point of the time. Okay, so we can't say that we have the modern development based on some of the Western societies. Okay, that was also not there, but we refer this period, you can refer this period as a colonial period, because this colonial period is also, you know, associated with the British also. Okay, so British established their control over India and made their colony, as you know that. Okay, and they have set up the colonization in terms of, you know, the subjugating the Indians, right? And also bringing complete changes in terms of the political, in terms of basically your economic, in terms of your social, in terms of your cultural changes. So they have made changes, the political, economic, and social, and the cultural changes by subjugating, right, the people, by subjugating the people or subjugating the entire process. So historians basically use different sources, okay? That was, you know, about 250 years of the Indian history, which is, you know, related to the British also, okay? So what we have done, or what the historians has done, they have gone through the official records of the British administration, okay? So based on the official records of the British administration, okay, you know, the British believed that act of writing was very important, okay? So that, based on that belief, because administration would be much easy if you written down, right, the important aspects of administration, the policies, plans, everything will be written very clearly, okay? So obviously the Britishers basically preserve these important documents, letters, basically carefully, right? Obviously for the purpose of better administering the country, okay? So they set up basically the record rooms. These record rooms were attached to the administrative institutions, okay? These administrative institutions were basically, you know, related to the record, right, of such administration purpose, okay? Then the government of British, or the British government, also set up the important archives, the museums, right? These important archives and the museums were basically, you know, to preserve the important records that were basically associated with the administrative features of the Britain also, okay? And also the surveying was become more important, more common during the colonial administration, okay? And as you know that the detailed surveys were basically carried out, right, to, you know, to entire length and breadth of the country, to basically, you know, to govern this country efficiently and effectively, okay? And you know that the revenue surveys were basically conducted at the village level, because the Britishers were also more important to exploit the rural areas also, right, in order to garner the maximum amount of land revenue, okay? So revenue surveys were basically done, okay? And, you know, the census operations were also held. So that was, you know, that in 1881, the first census was conducted, okay? And so since 19th century, the census operation was also conducted on the regular interval of 10 years that will provide the British administration, right, about the social makeup of our country, okay? So social makeup of our country is also very important, because without understanding the social structure, you cannot govern the country. That was the most important aspect to be governed, okay? Now, they prepare, right? They prepared, you know, all detailed records, right, related to the number of people in every provinces, okay? Then the information related to the caste, religion, occupations. So they have all information related to all such parameters. And that too, every such records were basically put down as a official records. Okay. That is something to be very important. And these records, you know, help us to understand whether, you know, what the Britishers want, what was their main motto, whether their real motto was to develop the country or their real motto was to drain the country, okay? And what was the effect of such policies on the British, on the basically the common people, that was also understood with the help of these records, okay? Now, to know more about these things, we have the diaries of the people, the accounts of the pilgrims, travelers, the autobiographies, right? As you have seen, a lot of travelers, right? The autobiographies have been written by various, you know, the writers about the rulers. All such also given the important insights related to, you know, the rulers, specifically the colonial rulers, right? So all such sources were produced by those who were basically literate. Obviously, the illiterate person cannot produce their sources. So that was something which was produced by, you know, the literate persons, which was also, you know, related to the writing of such important autobiographies. Okay, now we will not be able to understand how the history was experienced and lived by the tribals and the patients and the workers, right? Specifically those people who were basically, you know, in the streets, or who were basically, you know, stayed in the tribal societies, right? In the peasants, right? All such, you know, all such people basically experienced, right? You know, related to this colonial rule. Okay, now the chapter 2 is basically related to the trade to the territory. Okay, how the East India Company basically, you know, dominate itself over the Indian country, okay, or Indian continent. So that was the most important. Okay, now as you know that the East India Company came first in India, okay, or Indian subcontinent. So here I would explain you the British power began to emerge, right, in the second half of 18th century. Second half of 18th century, the British, you know, power began to emerge, right? The Britishers basically originally came to India as a small trading company, okay? And they were initially reluctant to acquire the territories, okay? The territories which were basically belongs to the Indian rulers. Ultimately, they become the masters of this vast territory, okay? But you must understand that this did not happen over the period of the time, but it took the longer period of the time. Okay, in 1600, right, the East India Company basically acquired a charter from the ruler of England. That was the Queen Elizabeth I. Okay, the Queen Elizabeth I gave, right, a charter to the British East India Company, granting it the sole right to trade with the East, that is to the East, right? And the Royal Charter, you must understand, could not prevent from other European powers from entering into the Eastern market. So the Portuguese also established their presence in the western coast of India, as you know, okay, and got their bases specifically in the Goa, right? And by 17th century, right, the Dutch also, you know, started exploring the possibilities of the trade in Indian Ocean, okay? And soon the French traders also arrived, right? So the French, Dutch, Portuguese, apart from the English, they came, okay? So all such companies, or all such East India companies, wanted to buy the same thing, that is, you know, what they were initially interested in, basically the cotton, silk, pepper, cloves, cardamom, okay, cinnamon, okay. So all such companies, basically, they want to interested in trading of these items, specifically from the Indian market, right? So the competition among these Portuguese, you know, the French, right, and your English basically started growing, okay? So that pushed up the prices at which these goods could be purchased because of the competition between them, okay? Now, that has ultimately reduced the profit that could be earned by these companies, right? So they want to earn more and more profit. How would they earn more and more profit? Obviously, by eliminating other companies. So they have to eliminate other companies, then only they can basically flourish. So this started the war, or the rivalry between them. Okay, so the first English factory was set up on the banks of River Hooghly. So that was the English factory that was set up on the bank of River Hooghly, okay, in 1651. That was the first English factory was set up, okay? And slowly the trade related, you know, activities basically expanded, right? And East India Company persuaded the merchants, traders who were there to come and settle nearby the factory, which was set up nearby the River Hooghly in Kolkata, right? And what happens is by 1696, right, they started building the fort, right, around the settlement. That was the factory which they have built, right? They also bribed the Mughal official, right, to giving the company Jamidars right over the three villages, okay? Right, so that was basically the bribing activities were also there. They also persuaded the Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb to issue a farman, okay? So that farman were basically related to the granting the company right to trade, right? The duty-free, the right to trade duty-free aspect, okay? That was also related to the issuing of the farman that was issued by the Aurangzeb. The official of the company is basically, they were carrying out the private trade, specifically, you know, related to, all such items which were basically there. Okay. So they were carrying out, but they were expected to pay the duty. But what happens is they refuse to pay those duties. Okay. So what happens if they refuse to pay the duties? Obviously, that basically, you know, angered the Nawab of Bengal. That was Murshid Quli Khan. So that were basically, you know, angered due to the factor when they started not paying the duty to the Nawab of Bengal. Okay. So what happens is after the death of Bengal, after the death of Aurangzeb, especially the death of Aurangzeb, okay, has led to, right, the Bengal Nawabs that were basically the Murshid Quli Khan, Alawardi Khan, and your Sirajuddaulah, right? They also refused to grant concession to the company. Okay. Now, in such situation, right, the company officials started thinking that to replace the Sirajuddaulah, right, with the puppet ruler. So they want to replace the Sirajuddaulah with a puppet ruler who could give the company, right, as a concession and the privilege. Okay. Now, what the British East India Company, what they do, they started, you know, helping some of, you know, one of the Sirajuddaulah's rival, right, to become the Nawab. And in that meanwhile, in the process, the Sirajuddaulah basically got infuriated. Okay. And that finally led to the Battle of Plassey. Right. And in that Battle of Plassey, right, the Sirajuddaulah got defeated. Okay. So the Sirajuddaulah succeeded the Alawardi Khan. Okay. That was the time. Okay. The company, right, the main reasons for this defeat of the Nawab Sirajuddaulah was that the forces which was led by the Mir Jafar, that was the Sirajuddaulah's commander, basically never fought the battle, right? And for the British East India Company, it was a won this Battle of Plassey, and that was the most important fight, right? Basically to control specifically in the Bengal, Bihar and Orissa, right? That was also most important time. And Mr. Jafar, right, who was basically a commander, right, you know, who had deceived the Sirajuddaulah, right, was made a new Nawab of Bengal. So he was become the new Nawab of Bengal. So Mir Jafar was basically become the new Nawab of Bengal. Okay. But the Mir Jafar also could not prove, right, himself as a puppet ruler for the longer period of the time. Now, the Britishers could have to deposed him, okay, or could have to remove him, right, and installed the Mir Kashir, right, in his place. That was also the most important aspect. When the Mir Qasim complained, okay, related to, right, he in turn was defeated in the Battle of Buxar that was happened in 1764. So in the Battle of Buxar, right, you know, the Mir Qasim was also made the Nawab of Bengal after Mir Jafar. So that was also the time when the Britishers basically tried to support, right, all such rulers who were basically, you know, giving the more favor to the Britishers. Okay. And in the same year, the Mughal emperor appointed the company, right, as the Diwan of the provinces of Bengal. Okay. Now the company now began to exploit the vast revenue resources of Bengal. Okay. So after the Battle of Buxar, okay, the company appointed, you know, basically, you know, the residents in the Indian state. Okay. These residents, which were basically appointed, right, by the company, right, these residents were basically the political and commercial agents, right? These were political and commercial agents. These were political and the commercial agents, right? Their job was to serve and further the interest of the company. So to promote the interest of the company, right? And, you know, through these residents, the company began to interfere in the internal matters of Indian state also, right? Soon the company forces the states to have the subsidiary alliances, right? And according to that, these alliances, the Indian rulers were not to allow to have their independent armed forces. So they were denied to have the independent armed forces under subsidiary alliances. So they forced that the state to enter into the subsidiary alliances, right? And through that process, they were protected by the company, okay? And, you know, but they had to pay, you know, for the subsidiary forces, right? The company was supposed to maintain for the purpose for their protection. So for that purpose, they have to pay for it, right? And if the Indian rulers have failed to provide this, you know, this, you know, the money to the British for maintaining the subsidiary forces, right, their part of their territory was taken away. Okay. For example, the Awadh and the Bengal were basically, you know, forced to cede their territory on this ground because they failed to pay for their subsidiary forces. Okay. No, whenever the Britishers basically find the threat to their political and the economic interest, right, it basically resulted the direct military confrontation. Okay, in this regard, right, the Mysore was very important because in the Mysore they started beginning, you know, direct military confrontation also. Okay, so Mysore had become the more powerful under the ruler that is called Haider Ali, right? That is called Haider Ali. Okay. So under Haider Ali, the Mysore become more powerful. And also his son Tipu Sultan, okay, who had made the Mysore more stronger, more prosperous. The Mysore basically controlled the profitable trade of the Malabar coast. Okay. When the company purchased the pepper and the cardamom. Okay. So the Malabar coast, the trade were basically profitable, right? At that point of the time, the Tipu Sultan stopped the export of sandalwood, pepper, and the cardamom through parts of his kingdom. Okay. And basically the Tipu Sultan disallowed, okay, the local merchants from trading with the company. So obviously his purpose was to, you know, to consolidate their power. This step of restricting the local merchants, right, from trading with the company basically infuriated the company. And what happens is the company, for that particular reason of, you know, controlling this trade, fought 4 wars with the Mysore. Okay, you know, and in the last war, that was the battle of Seringapatnam, okay, you know, the company ultimately won the victory. So here the company basically won the victory, okay, and Tipu Sultan was basically killed defending his capital, that was at that point of the time Seringapatnam. Okay, so Tipu Sultan was basically killed, okay, and ultimately the company also subdued the Marathas in the series of wars also in this process. Okay, so Marathas of the wars with the Marathas was also started. The company started subdued the Marathas in the series of the war. Okay, so here what happens is the third battle of Panipat basically shattered the dream of the Marathas to rule the India from Delhi, right? It also led to the division of the Marathas Confederacy, Okay, so here you will have basically, the four chiefs which were ruled from four centers under the Peshwa based in the Pune. Okay, and I told you the subsidiary alliance which was introduced by the Lord Wellesley, okay, where the Indian states were used to accept or forced to accept the resident or British resident. These British residents were basically the political agent of the British. Okay, so they had to control every aspect of the state, and in return, they have to, maintain, a subsidiary army, right? That will basically protect the state, and they have to pay for this army also. Okay, so subsidiary armed force, the British was maintained to protect, the states from external aggression, but the states has to pay for their maintenance. Okay, for the troops, for their maintenance. If they don't pay, what will happen? A part of the territory was basically taken away. Right, under the subsidiary alliances. Okay, so that was the time when this was basically was more important. Okay, next is basically your the doctrine of lapse. Now what happens is, in from early 19th century, okay, the company persuaded the aggressive policies of territorial extension or territorial expansion. Okay, so British basically pursued, the aggressive territorial expansion policy. So under Governor General Lord Hastings, okay, let's start with the Lord Hastings. Okay, from 1813 to 1823, the new policy of paramountcy was basically started. Okay, now the company started claiming that its authority was paramount or supreme. So that was, the policy of paramountcy. So the company was started claiming that its authority is paramount. Okay, and following this one, the company basically annexed, different regions or different states also. Then under the Governor General of Lord Dalhousie, like what happens is, the annexations was basically at the peak. So he devised the policy that is known as the doctrine of lapse. Okay, so the doctrine of lapse, that was the policy that was deduced by the Governor General Lord Dalhousie. The doctrine declared that if the Indian ruler died without male heir, okay, if the Indian ruler died without a male heir, right, his kingdom would become, a part of the company territory. So that means without any natural male heir, the kingdoms or the territory of a particular king would be annexed with the British territory. Okay, and that will become part of the company's territory. Okay, in this process, Satara, Sambalpur, Udaipur, Nagpur, Jhansi, all were basically subdued, right? Basically, under, the doctrine of lapse. And ultimately in 1856, okay, the company also took over the Awadh, right? The company also took over the Awadh, okay? And the when Warren Hastings was become the first Governor General of India, right? He also started several administrative reforms, right? Specifically in the field of justice, okay? So in the early 19th century, the British developed the uniform military culture, right? The soldiers were bigger, were basically increasingly, subjected to the European style training, drill, discipline, and all sort of things. Okay. Thus, you can say that the British East India Company has transformed from the trading company to the territorial colonial power, right? So it has transformed itself to the territorial colonial power. So that is the finishing of your chapter 2, okay? And we will cover up this chapter in our next class, okay? That is the third chapter. So thank you very much. That's all for today. And we will meet tomorrow for our next session.